talk about financial industry, first thing, you must know these things are financial sector blueprint. Okay? 2 years back until 2020. So this key area, focus area by Bank of America, so that they want to move financial industry moving forward. So what are the areas they are looking at? First thing first, they look at the businesses. All those business companies, Bank of America wants to have provide those financial assistance, financing that kind of things, to make sure all businesses in Malaysia that get funding easier, okay, and faster also, at a cheaper rate also. Okay, these are things for businesses. But for household, they think that education, retirement, healthcare products are currently, honestly, in Malaysia, still lack of this kind of innovative products. Because many products in Malaysia is very pure vanilla from outside. Which means if overseas, you go to Singapore, you find such products, Malaysia doesn't have one. Okay? Then Malaysia do have how we as an advisor to offer this kind of solutions to our clients. That's why many Malaysians they cannot find that kind of solutions because Malaysia don't have. Okay, not in one field hand. And then that's why you see complicated products coming soon. Obviously coming soon. This is financial blueprint. And then why wealth management industry will continue to grow? This is wealth management. We're talking about money matters, investment, saving, okay, wealth management. First, also, we look at the blueprint also. This is current one, mainstream, mass affluent, okay. They are distributing products via retail banking, insurance currently, companies, stock again, unit trust company. This is over, passes already. Going forward, for mass affluent means those a little bit high income earners, right? Because Malaysia, our Prime Minister said, we want to move Malaysia towards high income nation, right? I agree also, high income nation, everyone of us making more income is a good thing. But more income, high income earners, the products they want is different one, totally different. That's why they have different kind of services, advice should be given to them, this kind of mass effort. And then going forward, lower high net worth clients, ultra high net worth, okay? Many Ipohians are high net worth one. Because their father, their grandfather is a mining company, the boss, but right now don't have mine, no more, right? But still have a lot of money, right? So they want to pass on their resources, their asset to the next generation, to the third generation, okay? Then they want different kind of solutions. But for normal advisors, they cannot provide that kind of advisor. Okay? These are talk about our skill, our knowledge. So this one, if you're moving forward, that's why you want to grow wealth management market. This is growing currently. How fast growing? Let's see. For unit trust market, next time maybe some of you join unit trust companies also, right? So you see, this is measured by security commissions. They want to see penetration rate double from 2010, 18% to 34% roughly by 2020, which means in Malaysia, every 10%, at least 3% already invested in unit trust. So far, any one of you here invested in unit trust? Got, right? No. Got also? Yes. Many, most of us are. Sure not. Then this is the wrong right here. Okay. But honestly, I tell my friends that invest in unit trust, they say very slow one. Then how? Very slow. Better I straight away I go into share market. Right? Got this kind of comment or not? Feedback. But then many of my clients last time I being a ISP investment bank, I tell them, hey, why not you just put a little money, invest in share market. But then they tell me, Alex, very risky, very volatile, I'm very scared one. Then how? Unit trust also do one, share also do one. all put into a fixed deposit. This is a career scenario. For my own case, I don't know, maybe Johor, Ipoh, different, KL. Many of my friends also like that. I don't know why. Because maybe they scared what they faced by their friends, their fathers, during 1997 financial crisis at that. Okay. And then for current level, you know, Malaysia market keep on dropping, right? Then they come back to me. See, Alex, luckily I didn't invest. Ah, make a very smart choice already, oh. Okay. But that one is temporary. You should invest current market, okay? But go back to the basic, stop picking. And then if you think that Malaysian market is not good, then you go to overseas. US is performing pretty well, okay, for the past 1 year. Also invested a bit of my money outside Malaysia. So if you think that Malaysia is the market very high, not so attractive, then invest your money outside. For me, investment is a must for us, especially next year, GST comes in. Your value, your money value, keep on depreciating. If you don't invest your money, okay, you just let inflation eat your money. This is a risk scenario. Okay, that's why you all should invest a little bit of your money outside, right? So these are things. And then for the latest one, this is September this year, 2 years, 2 months ago. Capital market integration. This is for Thailand, Malaysia, Singapore. These three countries are starting next year, January, next month onwards. Malaysia investor, you can directly invest in Thailand, invest in Singapore on their unit trust products. Okay? These companies even don't have to set up any office in Malaysia also can. For these three countries, they integrate together already. So this another asset management companies, they are going forward. You see, all those companies, many funds you come in, you also don't know, never heard about this kind of name. Currently, many of you heard about public mutual, right? Going forward, I tell you, public mutual is the first also. Okay? Many public mutual agents also feeling the pinch already currently. Okay? So these are things. You all should know this kind. And then, of course, PRS. Heard about PRS? Private retirement scheme, right? So this another services, product services, keeps on promoting by our regulators, by asset management companies. So this one is take care of your retirement benefits, your retirement funds. This is PRS. When you see the a lot of advertisement, TV, commercial advertisement, newspaper, promoting this kind of PRS scheme. Okay? So starting 2012, very new. That's why many of you maybe haven't heard about PRS. Okay? So I'm one of the PRS distributor, the pioneer one, 2012. I straight away I get the license from this. I don't have to sit for exam also because I'm a financial planner. I just attend 2 day course, I straight away I can get the license. Okay? And what's my client? So 2012, very new, right? But after all these kind of things are very beautiful things, I tell you, we have a problem over here. Really? We have a problem over here. The problem is, we lack of that kind of advisor, okay, in the market currently. So, maybe you yourself will ask these kind of questions. What's the best way to handle my mortgage? How am I going to transfer my assets to my next generation? And then make sure the wealth that I transfer can last more than 3 generations. Because Chinese always say, 富不过三代嘛, right? So many Chinese ultra high net worth, they keep thinking, I want to make sure my food can last more than 3 generations. So that my chuchu, my next generation also know my name, the grandfather. Okay, know my name. How? Okay, these kind of questions. And then, which investment should I plan for my retirement? Insurance. There are different kind of insurance products already. Okay, honestly. Compared with last time, yes, this started. This are normal, like, few products only. But currently, different, all different things already. So this is the reactions. Okay, this is the reaction. Mr. Bean come out already. Okay, Mr. Bean asked one. So this one, another one. That's why in order to handle this kind of questions, we must go back to basic. Okay, when we talk about investment, we are not talking about only investment return. We want to talk about, is it we can transfer? Okay, how much is the test is going to test on this kind of investment? Are there any exemption or whatever things, right? And then for investment, can I hedge against the currency risk also? Okay, and then we come to insurance products. So currently, when I buy insurance, do you know that some insurance products are is creditor proof, which means anything happened to you, creditor, your bank, how much you borrow from bank, the bank is the creditor, so much. Like you borrow PTPN loan, government is the creditor. In order for me, anything happened to me, this money, I give it to my beneficiary, and then I want to make sure my beneficiary get 100% of the money and creditor cannot touch. Do you know that there are differences? Okay? Many of us do know. Because when you go through insurance agent, maybe they only sell you insurance, they would advise you on whether creditor proof or not. They are different. If you are single, you buy insurance products, make sure you name your father, mother as your beneficiary. Then you fall under trust formation. You cannot, creditor cannot touch the money. If you are married, you name your husband or your wife as a beneficiary or your children. The creditor cannot touch the money also. But if you're married, you name your father, mother as your beneficiary, creditor can touch the money. So these are different things. That's why when you see insurance, we talk about protection. Yes, we talk about protection, but anything happens, the money pays out, it's fall under your estate already. Then we talk about estate planning already. Okay, so currently, the whole scenario, we must integrate the whole thing, the whole advice. We talk about insurance, we talk about estate planning also, we talk about retirement also. We talk about investment, we talk about estate planning also, we cannot run away from estate, right? So these kind of things, we must integrate all of them. So the challenges over here is that many of advisors in Malaysia, we do have this kind of skill, this kind of knowledge to integrate all of that, the whole picture. Okay, you go to insurance, you want to buy insurance, go to insurance agent, that's all, insurance agent. No? You go to investment, you go to find a public mutual consultant, agent, something. Okay, then they don't know other things, they only know investment. Right, so a story, funny story to you. This is what I encountered, okay. When I ask my clients to invest in, no investment. Very simple one, create a child education fund, okay? Plan for your children education, right? So basically, we have two options. One is invest your money, right? Invest your money, share market into unit trust. Normally, people use unit trust as investment for child education funding, okay? Regular investment, after 18 years, the children graduate, SPM, then come to Utah. No need to borrow PTPN, but father got money for you. Good, right? Okay, these are things. So, when you go to investment, you talk to the right person, or whether you talk to the right person, if not, you go to public mutual consultant, you go to, I always mention public mutual, next time go. I don't have public mutual agent also very good one, okay. Unit trust consultant, okay. When you go to unit trust consultant, of course, they will say, hey, you should create your funding via unit trust investment. Why? Higher return. Okay? But they didn't tell you, got risk also. Okay? Then you go to insurance agent will tell you, unit trust no good. You go for education, we want some security, some guarantee, that kind of features. Then you should put your money into insurance endowment plan. But endowment plan, you compare with unit trust investment, the return, I can guarantee you, cannot be more than 6% every year. If your insurance agent tell you that the return is 20% per year, okay, then it's leading already. Okay, so these are things. Both products and services have its own pros and cons. Okay, so back to you, which one you choose. Right? So, if you talk to insurance agent, of course, go to endowment. You talk to initial consultant, go to investment. Okay, but investment, you don't have that kind of protections in case you yourself as a payer, okay, not around anymore. So investment can still continue. Your plan will disrupt. But insurance got this kind of features. But insurance compared to basic, when you talk about education funding, you need money. I want the investment return, right? So both has its own pros and cons. For me, go to both side. Okay. Some allocate where endowment, some allocate to investment. It's a better way. But you talk to any one single product and services providers, then 100% they'll say 100% good to them already. So depends on what kind of advice you get there. So these are things. Right? So that's why the solutions over here, this year we have many solutions already. And recently comes out again. So solution, want to listen? Solution. Number one, that's why in order for Malaysia to move forward, okay, in order for advisors to have better advice to general public like you all. So that's why Bank of China also lower down, okay, expand their requirements to say that to become a financial advisor representative, which means this when you get the license, this license you can market multiple insurance companies products, okay, under single platform. Currently, you want to have a Great Eastern policy, you go to Great Eastern agent, right? You want Prudential policy, you go to Prudential agent. But once you got your financial advisor representative license, you yourself can represent all of the insurance companies in Malaysia. Is it better? Better, right? So this is one of the requirements. Maybe in the future, you all can consider also to get this kind of license also, right? So in order for you to have to go through 7 modules, starting this year, September, when the guy say you go through 3 modules, enough already. You can become financial advisor. Okay? This is for insurance. And then for security commissions, CMSRI holders like me. Last time I also feel not fair. Because last time I sit for 7 modules. Right now you see 3 modules only. Plus 1 certificate only. Then you can become same like me. Okay? But they want to expand the requirements, okay? So these are 3 modules also for security commission. Then you can represent multiple unit trust companies, multiple share trading brokerage house also. So for this one, is it good also? Better, right? So these are things. And of course, I always encourage, because every year I will accept few internship students under my care. I will guide them what is the proper way of doing financial planning, that kind of things. And then I always encourage them, you all can go for further study yourself to sit for this kind of exam so that you have that kind of knowledge inside you. Okay? So and then for CFP certifications also, instead of 6 modules, you go through 4 modules enough already. So starting next year, new intake for them, okay? So this is further studies for your own self, your own good, right? And then this is a good news for you all. Just now I mentioned, I don't know what is the code, but this is the subject, right? This is the subject. So if you study business admin, finance, accounting, right? You take this kind of subjects, you can have extension, okay? Some exception of this kind of modules papers. So fast track your certifications also. So you can consider all this. And then this is not updated list. I still can't manage to get the updated list from the regulators, from the bodies. But you can on and off, you can check with MFPC, Malaysia Financial Planning Council, to see whether your cost entitled for a certain exemption for how many papers that I have. Right? And then Before I move on, any questions so far? No question. So you all want to continue as in this industry or not, financial industry? The one already. It's very good lah. So far, because you cannot run away. Every time anyone here don't have bank account. Got ma, right? Everyone also got bank account. That's why every time you get your money, first thing, you must open bank account already. You get your paycheck. Now, nowadays, many companies, they don't issue check one. They straight away bank into your account one. Okay? Anyone don't have a debit card, ATM card? Sure got, right? A credit card maybe you don't have. But debit card sure have. Okay? So these kind of things, you can run away from banking services. That's why, when the economy keeps on expanding, keeps on growing, this is the backbone of the economy, financial industry. Okay? Especially for accounting students. Going forward, you all should study more on those GST accounting standards, procedures, that kind of things. This is the demand side. I got my cousin, accounting, he opened accounting firm. Keep on chasing me for 2 months already. Ask me, Alex, do you have any candidate? I want to employ 2 more accountant. Fresh grad also no problem one. 2 months. No candidate. No, still got vacancy. If you got friends, I want to join accountant, accounting firm, tell me. Tell me really urgent. Because many, if you open you open your newspaper and see for vacancies, I believe 10, okay? Out of 10, got 7 vacancies is accountant currently. I don't know why. Because many accountant, current assistant accountant, they run away already, they scared about GST coming. I don't know, I better change job already. That's why they keep on finding accountant currently. This is what really happening. Right? If you don't believe, later you go out, you check online, job search, there are a lot of vacancies currently. Right? So, if not, then I will move on. So, this is a quick tips for you all. Quick tips for you all to have better understanding. And when I forget the video. I got gift over here. So later you all give me some feedback, I give you some gift. Fair. Okay. So for beginners, we'll talk about financial planning. We always mention about this. When you started your first job, you get your first paycheck, then you start to accumulate your wealth, right? Wealth accumulation process. And then after that, when you retire, then you keep on consuming your wealth because you're no more working. Then you keep on spending. Okay? Wealth consumption for that. So until your last day, farewell. Okay? So, but first thing first, you must ensure whatever things you have. Protection comes first. Always mention protection comes first. Okay? Give you one scenario. Many people say that, Alex, I don't believe in insurance one. Honestly, I also don't believe in insurance. That's why I went into investment industry when I graduated at the time, right? So many people will think that insurance not necessary one. Because if I have money, I don't have insurance, but I for money I can pay for my medical bills. Right? It's a good one. Yes, provided you have money enough. Enough money. And then many people say that, Alex, I want to go for investment. I'm really interested in investment. You teach me investment. Okay, I ask him. Okay, let's say you want to buy a house. Okay, you want to have a 100,000 down payment for next 5 years. Okay, so every year you must have saving investment 20,000, right? So, in order to move up the plan, every month we break down. Every month you invest how much. Depends on the rate of return, then you can achieve your goals. After 5 years, you get your 100,000 free for down payment to buy your to purchase your first house, that kind of things, right? So, in order for you to fulfill this kind of dreams, these are objective. You must not forget that anything happens along these 5 years, within these 5 years, anything happens, let's say for the third year, no cancer, accident only, enough, accident only, then doctors tell you that, hey, you must perform operation right now. If not, maybe you cannot walk anymore. Okay? So how? Who is the one going to pay for a medical bill if you don't have insurance? And then after you, let's say there are two options for you. One option is that whatever investment amount invested for the past 3 years, you have to take out already. Right? After you take out, you want to continue the plan? Cannot, because from starting from zero again. So you disrupt your investment plan already. Right? So that's why when you talk about investment plan, first thing, we go back to basic first. See whether you got enough coverage or not. If you got enough coverage, of course, the excess money you put into investment, put into saving. Don't always purchase insurance. Insurance is for protection. Okay, I saw many of us, some people said investment got risk, I don't want to keep on purchasing insurance. Wow. This kind of clients also very good. For insurance agent, it's very good. Keep on purchasing insurance, I don't believe in investment. Also got this kind of person. Okay, for me, as an advisor, we advise both sides. Okay, if you have enough coverage, then you should put your excess money into investment. No more be insurance. Agree? Agree, yeah? Okay, good. Then we can move on. Think. First one. When you talk about insurance, when you talk about investment, then you go back to basic. Hey, unless I get my first paycheck, okay, then how much should I invest? How much should I buy for insurance? Okay. The basic thing is that I always mention to all those fresh graduates, before you get your first paycheck, you must start to do these kind of things, budgeting. Anyone of you over here jot down every day your daily expenses? No one. No one. That's why Malaysian financial planning failed. Really? I jot down all my expenses every day, daily basis, 10 years ago. I started this kind of things 10 years, this action. Okay? You all should start this kind of practice also. Okay, why doing budgeting is a must? Because if you don't do budgeting, then how are you going to know whether this month I got surplus money? Right? Then how much saving you save for this month? You don't know. Because you don't track your record. How are you going to monitor? Right? How much expenses I pay for, I use for my petrol this month? I don't know. See the bill comes then, right? No. Then see the bill comes again. Oh, this month got insurance premium, car insurance, every year once. Okay, I forget. This one got off. Then I don't have enough money already because I spent. Okay, I thought I saved 200 per month enough. But this month got insurance premium comes up 2,000. Then how to find the shortfall 1,008? Then you borrow money, use credit card, that kind of thing. Right? That's why you all should keep all your record in proper place. Okay? And for nowadays it's very simple for you all. You just everyone here got iPhone, right? Got an iPhone. Smartphone, right? So smartphone, there are many apps out there, okay, to track your expenses. You can simply download one. Okay. You can every time you drink water only 60 cents nowadays. So you check. And then after that, the first thing before you drink, you mark down, key inside your app to track your expenses. And then the app are very changy nowadays. Because after every month, you can straight away press a button, that will break down food and beverage, how much you spend, petrol, how much you spend, insurance premium, how much you spend, everything break down already. So next time you see, if I want to cut my expenses, on food and beverage, then you know how much roughly you can cut. These are very good apps nowadays, right? But the apps are not developed by me, got disclaimer, I don't know whether it's correct or not. But my wife also using that kind of apps currently. But for me, I'm a very traditional person. I'm using Excel spreadsheet. Because I want to customize according to my needs, okay? What I want to focus is different, okay? I'm using spreadsheet. Because 10 years ago, don't have app one. I'm very traditional person, right? So this is one. From today almost later, you walk up, start downloading that kind of app, doing budgeting. After budgeting, then you should differentiate, okay? Between needs and wants. Anyone here can answer. What's our difference? I got gift for you all. Anyone want to answer? Want to try? Yes.
In economics, we say needs, wants are unlimited, needs are limited because of lack of resources. I mean, and wants can be like anything, but needs like for survival and everyday life, the things that we need to survive for needs. Mm. You say,
Okay, correct? Correct, yes. Thanks. I give you this one. Stress ball, very stressed. So, Uzbekistan know, Malaysia do not. Okay, so this is between needs and wants. Needs is something that is necessary, daily life. This is what you call needs. And then wants is that you want only, actually don't need one. Okay, so different thing. Example, you need to drink water, right? Okay. Burger, right? So this is Nokia. Sorry, this one updated already. Nokia handphone, not Nokia, handphone, okay? But nowadays, this is one slot. Instead of drink water, you buy Starbucks, okay? Instead of lolly burger, you go to McDonald's, okay? Instead of handphone, you go to smartphone, but for me, different nowadays, smartphone already, okay? These are things. So these are different. Once you identify between needs and wants, first of all, your priority of your money spending expenses should go to this side, right? If you have excess money, then only you go to this side. Okay? So they are there. And then, that's why when you do budgeting, you can differentiate between needs and wants. When GST comes in, you want to save more, right? Cut costs, then you know where to cut. You cut your wants, but needs cannot cut already, right? So I have another talk for you all. So in order for you to save more, right? Many people say that, hey, how much you save is how much you earn. Let's say you're earning 10,000 per month, okay? You save 5,000, this is your saving, right? So if let's say economy no good, okay, you want to save more, you want to cut costs, whatever things are, you cut maximum 5,000, right? But my thought is that don't always go for cutting costs. Cutting costs, there's a limitation one. Because some costs are is needs, you cannot cut anymore. You should focus on growing your wealth, find more money, okay? Because many outside, all those financial books tell you, cut costs. Anything happen, got debt now, got everything, cut costs, first thing. Then they didn't tell you the other option. You should find looking for more money, okay? If you are in debt, instead of cut costs only, you should go to find part-time job, making extra money for yourself, right? So these are two things. And then after that, when you do your money allocations, how are you going to allocate mortgage, credit card, insurance, food, utilities, these kind of things? So I gave you the golden rule, golden formula. Golden formula over here, 6-3-1. Anyone can help me to identify how am I going to allocate between these 6-3-1? Got study or not? Not yet study. This course is by MSU. course of? Anyone want to try? Other than the sister there. Any other person want to try? 6-3-1. 6 for what purpose? 3 for what purpose? And 1 for what kind of purpose? Yes? Want to try? Okay, good. Correct, okay. Correct. 66%. Okay, this for you. Good try. Okay. Right, so my philosophy is that one is spend expenses, correct one. Okay, you get your paycheck, 60% of your money, you can go for expenses. Okay, as a financial planner, I cannot tell you 100% go to saving one. Okay, you still have to spend one. Work-life balances one, right? And then send and invest 30% of your money. 10% you go for your protection. So then you complete. This is a basic one, rules of thumb, the golden formula currently. But honestly, for fresh grad, very hard for you to maintain this 631. Honestly. Okay. Your expenses for fresh grad easily hitting 70% already. Okay. If you buy a car, maybe easily hitting 80% already for fresh grad. But for fresh grad is normal, 70% expenses. Try to maintain 20% saving. Okay? Try to maintain 20% saving. But insurance, 10%, yes. For me, fresh grad 10% a little bit more. I will only advise, let's say 5%. 5% of your monthly income go for insurance premium enough. Starting that. But along the way, when you have more income, of course you can start to increase your premium, increase your coverage from there onwards. At least you get the basic plan first. Right? So these are golden formulas.